We tried to get it to that. It's not hard to stand still. I will let them just do that.
You need to.
All right, guys, y'all can come on, and I'll stand right here. Oh, thank you. It's water, but thank you. May peace of Christ be with you.
At this point, we like to speak into our presence those who are not with us today. And today, that's a lot of folks. But we also always want to begin by speaking into our presence the beloved community that meets in La Vallita, Cuba, our sister church, pastored by Pastor Sila. We speak them into our presence and with joyful hearts worship with them each week. It never fails to give me chills a little bit when we speak them into our presence. And remember, those of you who have visited the church, you know they meet in a concrete structure that is filled with love and so much compassion for each other. And so to bring that energy and that love into this space is a beautiful thing. We will be going back to Cuba, so start putting your money away now. So when we are able, we are going back, Cindy. We'll see if we can get you a longboat to get there. But others who are not here, we've already mentioned Eddie and Ann, and also Robin, others. That, Adam is not here today, and Gabby. Jennifer and the children. Craig and Chris. Craig's guarding my slaw. That's what Craig's up to right now. David, thank you. Beth, thank you, Cliff. Dana's online, but thank you, Jeff. Dana's online. Here in our presence, we have Litzy and Jerry and Cindy and Karen and Cliff and Trellis and Sam and Jeff. And you see Kim and also Michael and Jay, of course, always working the camera. Thank you, Jay. Let us worship God together. 55.
Now feel free to stand if you like, for Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Light of your love shining in the midst of the dark, shining in the
Hey.
You're up. Yeah.
Sure. This comes right before my favorite psalm. It's 90, 12 through 17, am I correct?
Yes, that's right.
Okay. Teach us to number our days all right, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Relent, O Lord, how long will it be? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad in all our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, for as many years as we have been in trouble, as we have seen trouble. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to their children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Thank you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You're welcome.
I told Cliff that when he joined the church, we're going to put him to work. We might not even wait till he joined the church. And so thank you so much, Cliff. We appreciate your leadership. As we come to our time of prayers of the people, I have been burdened particularly this week by our educators. I don't know if you don't work in education, you may not realize what a hard month October has always been for educators, particularly those in high school. A lot of the fall sports are just really manic at this time of year, but also students who are applying for colleges, juniors and seniors, are asking for reference letters and all of that. Even in the colleges, the college students applying for graduate schools are asking for reference letters or job recommendations. But not only that, in the younger grades, the students are sort of trying to get into the rhythm of school. And what I'm hearing is that students are just confused. Like, we've been out of school for a year and a half and now we're back, and it's just so hard to get used to. And so I would like for us to particularly pray for those in education. And let's also remember that includes custodians and office workers and cafeteria workers and transportation and teachers' assistants. It is our teachers, but it's all of the others as well who are public servants, who really just make the world better for us by providing public education. And so I want us to remember them always, but particularly in today's time of prayer. We also can never get too far away from COVID for a lot of reasons, but we really can't forget our nurses and staff workers at hospitals, also including cafeteria workers, transportation people, custodians, and also nurses, especially our own Michael, who works in COVID ICU at the Veterans Hospital, where there are so many other mitigating conditions as well, with liver and all of the other problems that are so common at the Veterans Affairs Hospital. So with those two groups in our mind especially, let us go to God in prayer. Loving God, we thank you for this time we can come together and worship you. We are grateful for technology that connects us from coast to coast and from presence to virtual attendance. We thank you for these opportunities to be communities, these unexpected blessings from this unexpected time. We thank you for those who sacrifice on so many levels to keep the peace, bring what normalcy there is and keep us safe to care for our loved ones, whether they are students in school or patients in hospitals. We thank you for all of those public servants who sacrifice so much for us, our nurses, our hospital workers, from the CEOs to the doctors, to the custodians, to the surgeons. And for our public school servants, from the central office to the teacher's assistants who monitor the playground, to those who feel like their primary job is reminding students to pull their masks up, for those who understand that children only get this one good meal a day, for broken hearts in the schools and in the hospitals, oh God, we ask your healing and hope. Lord, there are so many who weigh heavy on our hearts, and so now we lift those names to you and ask, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Aiden.
Sherry Housen Fisher and her loss this week.
Jennifer. Randy.
Randy Lawrence.
Seth Dawson.
David Cook.
Jan DeMays.
Jermaine and Chris. And also Paco, whose surgery got postponed until maybe tomorrow or Tuesday.
Mary and Nina. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
And now let us pray as Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand for our second hymn.
The number 11 for Blessed Assurance.
Number 11.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Savior all the day long. This is my story.
today. Our book is Last Stop on Market Street. Words by Matt de la Pena. Pictures by Christian Robinson. CJ pushed through the church doors, skipped down the street. The outside air smelled like freedom, but it also smelled like rain, which freckled CJ's shirt and dripped down his nose. From the bus stop, he watched water pool on flower petals, watched rain patter against the windshield of a nearby car. His friend Colby climbed in, gave CJ a wave, and drove off with his dad. Nana, how come we don't got a car? Boy, what do we need a car for? We got a bus that breathes fire. The bus creaked to a stop in front of them. It sighed and sagged, and the doors swung open. They sat right up front. The man across the way was tuning a guitar. An old woman with curlers had butterflies in a jar. Nana gave everyone a great big smile and a good afternoon. She made sure CJ did the same. The bus lurched forward, and stopped. Nana hummed as she knit. How come we always got to go here after church? CJ said. Miguel and Colby never have to go nowhere. I feel sorry for them, she told him. They'll never get a chance to meet Bobo or the sunglass man. And I hear Trixie got herself a brand new hat. CJ stared out the window, feeling sorry for himself. He watched cars zip by on either side, watched a group of boys hop curbs on bikes. Two older boys got on next. CJ watched as they moved on by and stood in back. Sure wish I had some of those headphones, he said. Nana sat down her knitting. What for? You got the real live thing sitting across from you. Why don't you ask the man if he'll play us a song? CJ didn't have to. The guitar player was already plucking strings and beginning to sing. The rhythm lifted CJ out of the bus, out of the busy city. CJ's chest grew full and he was lost in the sound, and the sound gave him the feeling of magic. The song ended and CJ opened his eyes. Everyone on the bus clapped, even the boys in the back. Nana glanced at the coin in CJ's palm. CJ dropped it in the man's hat. Last stop on Market Street, the bus driver said. CJ looked around as he stepped off the bus. Crumbling sidewalks and broken down doors, graffiti-tagged windows, and boarded up stores. He reached for his Nana's hand. How come it's always so dirty over here? She smiled and pointed to the sky. Sometimes when you're surrounded by dirt, CJ, you're a better witness for what's beautiful. CJ saw the perfect rainbow arching over the soup kitchen. He wondered how his Nana always found beautiful where he never even thought to look. He looked all around them again, at the bus rounding the corner out of sight, and the broken street lamp still lit up bright, and the stray cat shadows moving across the wall. When he spotted familiar faces in the window, he said, I'm glad we came. He thought his Nana might laugh her deep laugh, but she didn't. She patted him on the head and told him, me too, CJ. Now, come on. As CJ learned in the story, it can be easy for us to focus on what we don't have. CJ did not have a car or lots of other things others did, and he did not think that was one bit fair. But when he started looking around at all the wonderful things he did have, he learned that he was rich in all kinds of ways. And when he realized that, he was excited to share those riches with others. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for helping us to see our rich blessings. Help us to share all we have with others. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Trellis. When we had our prayer time today, I had a bit of good news and failed to share it. So let me do that now. I saw lots of good news this week. Among them, I learned that a woman was driving home one day with her kids in the back seat, and she noticed a house on fire. And so she pulled off the road and waved a passerby down, and they found out that there was a woman and her dog still in the house that was on fire. And so the passerby and a neighbor went in, and literally the woman had gotten dazed from the smoke, and they picked the chair up that the woman was in and carried her out to safety, went back and got the dog. And then one of the neighbor who had helped had a heart attack from the smoke, but the woman who had stopped knew CPR and she saved his life. So what an amazing story. Good news. Good neighbors. Another thing I learned this week was that in Lithuania, they have invented a totally green tractor. Apparently, farm expenditures, creating food, like oil, the oil used in the farm equipment is tremendous. And so this company in Lithuania moved to tackle the largest definitive source of fossil fuel use and created a hybrid electric tractor that uses biomethane, which is, yeah, it's caca, feces, turned into fuel. I mean, that's pretty impressive. And so then they're replicating this technology into a lot of other vehicles to create this clean and clearly very present source of energy. So anyway, those are two bits of good news this week. Our text for today comes from Amos. Amos is a prophet, and for the next 3 weeks at least, we're going to be in the prophets. Prophets are in what we call the Old Testament or the Hebrew Scriptures. So if you open your Bible to the middle, you're not quite at the prophets. So you're going to have to go a little towards the New Testament, or if you have your app, just search for Amos and pull it up. It's really not that hard. But if you have a real life Bible, you're going to go to a little past the center, to the book of Amos. It's a very short book. I'd have to start at Genesis to tell you exactly where it was. So look for Amos. Amos chapter 5, and our text today is a little split up. So we're going to read 6 and 7, and then we're going to read 10 through 15. But while you're looking that up, I wanted to tell you that Amos is a book that many of you, like a lot of things in Scripture, they're kind of part of the landscape, the public soundtrack of our lives. And one of these texts in Amos is like that. And it is in chapter 5, verse 24, and it is this text. But let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. A lot of us have heard that text before and thought it was maybe Ben Franklin or, you know, from Poor Richard's Almanac or something, but that is actually from Amos. And so that's the book we're in. Amos chapter 5, verse 6 and 7, and then 10 through 15. Hear the word of the Lord. Seek the Lord and live, or he will break out against the house of Joseph like fire and will devour Bethel with no one to quench it. Ah, you that turn justice to wormwood and bring righteousness to the ground. They hate the one who reproves in the gate, and they abhor the one who speaks the truth. Therefore, because you trample on the poor and take from them levies of grain, you have built houses of hewn stone, but shall not live in them. You have planted vineyards, pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink their wine. For I know how many are your transgressions And how great are your sins? You who afflict the righteous, who take a bribe and push aside the needy in the gate. Therefore, the prudent will keep silent in such a time, for this is an evil time. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you, just as you have said. Hate evil, love good, and establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I have a game on my phone that teaches me Spanish. So when I play it, I feel like I'm doing something good, you know, learning something, doing work. So what happens in the game is the vocabulary words drop from the top and you have to match them with their English interpretation counterpart. Thank you. So the vocabulary words drop and you match them. And there are different goals at different levels and you have to do different, hop through different hoops and so on because there is the game component. But here's the thing. Every time I win the level, I get a boost for the next round. Like I get a free word or an extra hint or whatever. But when I lose, I get penalized. And this got me to thinking. This happens in almost all games. In Yahtzee, if you are lucky enough to get Yahtzee, that is five of a kind on the dice, you get 50 points. But if you are so lucky that you get a second Yahtzee, you get 100 points. In Monopoly, game of capitalism, if you roll doubles, it's a good thing, and you get to go again. If you get put in jail, you lose your salary, and you have to pay. Imitates life a little bit. But back to my Spanish game. When I lose, it says, oh, don't worry, I'll give you five more hints, but you'll have to pay for them. 600 coins. I'm like, wait a minute, I'm losing here. How about cut me some slack? But no, the game takes from me when I'm losing and gives to me when I'm winning. And I think that is not fair. And it's that kind of injustice that Amos was talking about in today's text, you know, kind of. Biblical scholars believe that Amos is the oldest prophetic text. Now, this is hard for us who are Western thinkers because we think the Bible is organized chronologically in every way. That is, we think Genesis was written down first and Revelation was written down last. And that is true as long as it is true. But there are many cases where it is not true. For example, Mark, which is the second gospel, is the youngest gospel, but it is older than 1 Thessalonians, which is the oldest letter. I know. It bothers me too. I can't do anything about it, though. And so Amos, which comes after Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, all of those prophets, Amos comes after them, but it's considered to be the oldest. So it's important that we know that because we need to know what was happening in the time. It dates to around 760 BCE. And at this time, the country was already divided. So all right, you know I'm going to ask you to do this. We have to make the physical map, all right? So take your hands and do like this. I'm looking at the bottom. I'm looking at the earth. Y'all are looking at the top of the map here. So I have to switch it so that I can think. All right, so Israel is split into the Southern Kingdom and the Northern Kingdom, right? In the Northern Kingdom, you have Israel. And it is most of the territory. In the Southern Kingdom, down here, you have Judah. It is two tribes. It is a small area. Israel, up here, the capital is Samaria. Judah, down here, the capital is Jerusalem, okay? So this is already in place. This has been there for a long time. Been there so long, they've been two different nations so long, that people have sort of forgotten that it was ever an issue. They've forgotten that there was ever a fight to get there. And so by this time, King Uzziah is the king of Judah. And Uzziah was a great king. In fact, Uzziah is mentioned like, there's a great text in Isaiah, in the year that King Uzziah died. And it's because you're like, and then you know, oh, that must have been a bad year. Because it's like in the year that the shuttle crashed, in the year that Kennedy was shot. It's like that big year, in the year King Uzziah died. So Uzziah was considered a great king. He's ruling in Judah. Meanwhile, Jeroboam II is ruling in Israel. He's also a great king in a lot of ways, considered great by the people because he's a military king and he's conquering the area around them. And as he conquers the area around them, he's bringing money into the tribes of Israel. Well, again, remember, Israel up here, Judah down here, they're now their allies. And they're trading back and forth. Well, when your trade partners get a lot of money, that's good for you because they can buy more of your stuff. So things are, they're trading back and forth and things are going really well in Israel in the north, Judah in the south. If you put them in alphabetical order, it helps. IJ, north, south. And then remember, Jerusalem and Judah both start with J. And then Israel's capital is Samaria, IS. So there you go. You got it, right? You'll never forget that now. Beautiful. Mnemonics are a beautiful thing. Okay, so it's a great time. Jeroboam's a great king. Uzziah's a great king. There's lots of money flowing back and forth. There's peace. They're powerful. I mean, we know they don't, but we know because we've read the end of the story. That in just 40 years, Israel is going to fall to Assyria. But they don't know that yet. All they know is they got plenty of money, they got plenty of land, they're getting along with their neighbors, life is good. And so Amos's words must have sounded so out of tune to say, you better stop doing what you're doing. They're like, you mean living life? You mean enjoying the riches that we've worked so hard for? Amos says, look, if y'all don't stop it, things are going to get bad. And they had to have just been like, yeah, I don't know what your wicked ways, what are you talking about? Very simply. The problem was a problem of navel gazing. They had begun to believe that everything was all about them. They were turned inward. They were looking at their own prosperity and looking past the needs of others around them. Amos calls those people the poor in the gate. Amos, boy, he would really get in trouble with that kind of talk these days. If he spouted out something about how the poor should be treated with respect and the rich should share their wealth, he would be trolled on Twitter, mocked on Facebook, and vilified in the public discourse. What do you mean we need to share our wealth with them? We worked hard for this. We had to work for all of this. We didn't get any help. We pulled ourselves up by our bootstraps and worked for everything we've got. What do you mean we need to share that with? Oh man, the poor guy. He would have been run out off of the internet for that kind of talk. We know this because we see it all the time. But Canadian sculptor Timothy Schmaltz decided to take it one step further. He created a work he calls Homeless Jesus. Have you heard about it? It's a work of art done in bronze, and it's a statue that looks for all the world like a park bench occupied by a person without a home, sleeping, curled up, protecting himself with the blanket covering him. And from a distance, that's what you see. It looks like a person under a blanket asleep. It's only when you get closer that you realize that it is art and not life. And you realize this not only because it is bronze, but because you realize that the person depicted there is actually Jesus Christ, complete with bare nail-scarred feet. Schmaltz wanted, as many artists do, to challenge the common understanding of what it meant to live outdoors, what it meant not to have an actual address. And he sold this sculpture many times over, recasting it in bronze. Replicas of it are all over the United States and Canada, but also in Europe. Responses to the statue, as you can imagine, have been mixed. The rector of St. Barnabas Episcopal Church in Bay Village, Ohio, said, "Perhaps the statue will inspire those who see it to take action and help. Seeing Jesus depicted this way reminds us that Jesus identified with the outcast and marginalized in his own day." The rector was overly optimistic, because what actually happened was the church neighbors saw the vagrant and called the police. Unless we blame this behavior on Ohioans, the same thing happened when the statue was installed in Davidson, North Carolina. Within 20 minutes of it being installed, the police were called to investigate. Mind you, this was a statue. The person on the bench was not moving. The person on the bench was not threatening, was not sneaking around, was not doing anything that could be called illegal or threatening by a thinking mind. And so the response, not to go up and say, "Hey, buddy, how you doing?" Oh, it was to say, "Somebody get this fella out of here." Poverty is scary, and in itself, it threatens our way of life. We don't want to know about poverty. We don't want to know about this kind of pain. It's easier to believe, really, that we wouldn't be there. We couldn't be there. We're above that. That's on them. That's their fault. Amos does not mention park benches, but he does mention the poor in the gate. Now, we may not recognize that language, but in Amos's day, the gate, the city gate, was where the center of activity was, and it was there where the wealthiest people would gather, where the leaders in the city would gather, and it is also where the poor would go and petition for grace in their taxes or benefits from the local stores of goods. And so the excuse or the the accusation by Amos is that the people of his day are ignoring the poor who were there. Which just begs the question, what were they doing? Why were they there? Were they just trying to hang out with the people who were doing well? Were they wanting to stay within their own little bubble of sufficiency and excess? That because they were ignoring the poor there. And then Amos also says, you don't want to hear the people who speak the truth. You abhor those who speak the truth. And the ones who speak the truth about poverty and homelessness and injustice and inequity, you trample on them. So we have to ask ourselves, if Amos is talking about the center of public activity, where is our center of public activity today? What is our modern parallel to the poor in the gate? Our nation is so diverse, it would be hard to name one place. But I think one good place to start would be the internet. What we post online, like and retweet and favorite, says something about how we feel about other people. Do our messages that we promote online convey a message of superiority and authority and judgment? Do we encourage outrage at disagreement and indignation at minutia? The ability to spout our opinions to a ready audience has turned a lot of us into ex-smokers of the worst kind. Where the ex-smoker who stopped smoking a week ago, but stands in judgment of everyone who takes a puff. Can I get an amen? Yeah, okay, you're missing the whole point. But yeah, we don't punch them in the face. But you get the idea, right? That we get judgment there. We get like that. It's the person who's just started clean eating and can't bear to look at a Cheeto. It's the person who has started at a new gym. CrossFit, we're looking at you. And you can't believe that other people don't make physical activity a priority. We're the person who goes to church every Sunday. And we can't understand what is wrong with people. Why don't they make church a priority? We're so quick to judge. The messages that we put out there are a way that we trample on the poor, we trample on those who are different from us, whose struggles we have overcome. And we think by our own selves, we forget all the people that helped us to get there along the way. We forget all of the ways that we were favored from the very beginning. Cornel West says, and your quote is at the top of the bulletin today, that justice is love out loud, or love lived in the public. Cornel West is a Harvard professor, civil rights activist, who if you may have heard me say before, I like to listen to people who disagree with people on both sides of issues, because then I feel like I get close to the truth. Like if somebody's makes everybody mad, then and Pastor Guy Sales used to get hate mail from liberals for saying he was too conservative and from conservatives for saying he was too liberal. So I think that's the dream, right? And so Cornel West, he's got a lot to say that I do not agree with. But he has so much to say that is so powerful. And what he says about justice is that it's not enough to sit back and say, that's not right. Ooh, that's not right. That's not justice. Justice is up close. Justice is love in the public. Justice is love out loud where everybody can hear it. Justice builds relationships without giving advice. Justice reaches out when we don't have anything to offer in our own mind except our own hearts. Justice loves out loud. Justice doesn't worry about how the person got into the situation that they are in. Justice just loves them right where they are. If justice is love out loud, then that means then just that justice is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful. It's not arrogant or rude. Justice does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. Justice does not rejoice in wrong, but rejoices in the right. Justice bears all things, believes all things, endures all things, and hopes all things. We must allow ourselves to be challenged, to be interrupted and inconvenienced. Justice, it's not easy. Love isn't either. But we're not called to the easy way. We're called to the way of love, because that's the way of Jesus. Let us pray. Oh God, we confess that we do not want to love out loud. We don't want to be inconvenienced. We don't want to reach across boundaries that, oh gosh, they're just so big. But we can with your help. And it is that gift that we ask you for today. And we praise you in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You've heard the word of God today, sung and read, both from scripture and from children's literature. You've heard the word of God proclaimed, and now you are called to respond in whatever way you see fit. Some of you may respond by making a choice to follow Christ. Some may respond by choosing to join this church, and some of you may respond by choosing to join this church in our financial obligations. If you're watching online, you have a PayPal scan and go in your bulletin, and we have the offering plate up here if you are here in present. But in whatever way you respond, know that the Lord is calling you to love. We have a new song today, and I'll turn. Yeah. Come on, stand on up, and we'll listen to what that's about.
I thought of this song when I was reading the scripture, and then I think it echoes the sentiment of both, like specifics in your sermon and the song itself. Anyway, it's an older song. If you happen to know it, feel free to sing along, but it's not really a sing-along song if you don't know it. But the lyrics are there because I thought you guys might want to read along. Everybody gonna pray on the very last day. When they hear that bell ring the world away, everybody gonna pray to the heavens on the judgment day. Well, you can sing about the great King David, and you preach about the wisdom of Saul, but the judgment falls on all mankind when the trumpet sounds the call. All equal and the same when the Lord he calls your name. Get ready, brother, for that day. Everybody gonna pray on the very last day when they hear that bell ring the world. everybody gonna pray to the heavens on the judgment day. Well, one day soon all men will stand, His word will be needed in all the land. Men shall know and men shall see, we all are brothers and we all are free. Mankind was made of clay, each of us in the very same way. Get ready, brother, for that day. Everybody gonna pray on the very last day. Dust will go. No, the Lord once told us so. Each brother take his hand. Heed the meaning of the Lord's command. Get ready, brother, for that day. Everybody gonna pray on the very last day. When they hear that bell, ring the world away. Everybody gonna pray.
I need to remember to start early to get over here by the end of your song. Thank you, Michael, for that perfect song. By the way, those of you who are here, don't throw these sheets away. We'll hang on to them and add them to our pin books. Folks, we're not called to judge other people, no matter what their circumstances, because we know that we are all loved, and there is nothing you can do about it. Thanks for worshiping with Ecclesia. We'll see you next week.
Oh, by the way, I do notice the Bible reading.